I call this meeting to order of the Planning Board, May 27, 2004. I'm Paige Roberts, the Vice Chair of the Planning Board, sitting in for Ken Smith, who is out unexpectedly this evening. The single item that we'll be addressing this evening is the application of Public Service Company of New Hampshire owner for property located at 400 Gosling Road, wherein site plan approval is requested for the construction of the following. A, a wood fire boiler and other related appurtenances and structures. B, a stack. C, an air emission control device and ductwork. D, a wood storage yard, which will include a wood storage building, process building, and integrated conveyor system on storage building extended from lot 1 over the railroad parcel to lot 2A. And E, relocate fireside wash recycle basin and other related appurtenances and structures. All of the above reference items to be constructed with associated paving, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor Plan 214 as lots 1 and 2 and lies within a waterfront industrial district. And who will be addressing us this evening?
Madam Chair?
Yes.
As an abutter to the property, and as I'm going to be speaking to this application this evening, and the fact that I'm not properly dressed, I will be recusing myself from this application.
Okay, thank you.
Madam Chairman, I would like to request that we observe the 10:30 rule this evening, and that also as the presentation goes along, it looks like it's going to be a lengthy one, and I would like to request that we ask questions as we go, rather than saving them till the end of the entire presentation. I think it would help us considerably.
Okay, it makes sense to me. What is everyone agreeable to that?
Agreed.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Madam Chairman, members of the board, good evening. I'm Rob Chindella, Donahue Tucker and Chindella. We're acting as local land use counsel for PSNH for this project. I want to introduce you to our presentation. We've designed the presentation to be lean. It's a complicated subject, but we're going to try to move through it. We've designed the presentation to go about 75 minutes, and we expect to keep to that. Before I begin, I want to thank the board for giving up another Thursday. Your willingness to come forward, give up another night is consistent with the experience we've had with the city boards throughout this project. We've been at this since the fall with city administration and throughout the city administration, from the city manager down, the planning department has carried the heaviest load, and other departments, the public works as well. It's really everyone has gone above and beyond, and we're very grateful the amount of time and the quality of the attention we've received from everyone. We've met with TAC basically monthly since January, and the members of that committee have made themselves available generously. We've had a site walk and a hearing before traffic and safety. The ZBA, for the board's information, just to update really the planning department report, we did receive on the 25th of May the area variances we were seeking from the ZBA, so we have all the zoning approvals in place for this project. In addition, the ZBA, when we were over at the ZBA, they granted us a flexible procedure which allowed us to reach an agreement with an abutter, the Commerce Center abutters, on how the wood yard, you're going to hear about it in more detail, but how the wood yard would be laid out. And the agreement we've reached with those abutters is reflected in the wood yard layout you're going to see tonight. And we worked very hard to address concerns raised by the city and raised by other neighbors to the project and others interested. And I think you're going to see tonight a history of a sustained and focused and elaborate set of contacts with our residential neighbors in the area. And you're going to see the product of the work we've put into trying to ensure that there's visual and appropriate screening for our project. You'll also hear tonight that we believe we've reached basic agreement with the town of Newington on traffic mitigation issues. And that agreement, we believe, addresses the issues that have been raised by the malls as part of the process that's come before you. There's been a lot of process before you, and that's part of what we're going to try to build on to streamline our presentation. So, again, we appreciate the willingness of each of you to be here tonight, and I appreciate also that you read our application, which probably two Manhattan phone books. On behalf of the project, I do want to, again, for the record, thank the city other city boards and the city administration. What you're going to hear tonight from us is a relatively short lineup of main presenters. You're going to hear next from Dick Destins of PSNH. He's going to give you a project overview. We're then going to go to the site planning standards, and Dick is going to address some of them. I will address some, and you're going to hear from Tom Gorrell, the traffic consultant for the project, and from Terry DeWan, who will talk about landscape and screening issues, and then I'm going to close our presentation. Basically, this whole side of the room is consultants. So we have a short lineup with a very deep bench, and as Member Sullivan suggests, we're open for questions at any time, and so if you ask a question of a presenter, we may in turn drag up one of these consultants and make sure you get the answer to the question you pose. So with that, I'm going to turn this over now to Mr. Destins. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Dick Destins. I'm the station manager at Schiller Station. I have been in the power generation field at PSNH for 23 years. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to talk about the Northern Wood Power project tonight. It's pretty exciting because it's not very often we get to talk about a project or a concept that has tremendous benefits to both the environment and the economy at the same time. On the environmental side, this is a renewable energy project. Wood is an environmentally friendly fuel, and when we utilize it, we will be reducing sulfur dioxide emissions by over 85% and nitrogen oxide emissions by over 60%, which are impacts to acid rain and ground level ozone. And that is why we have the support of the Society for the Protection of New Hampshire Forests, New Hampshire Audubon Society, and the Seacoast Science Center, which I might add just celebrated their grand reopening recently. I would encourage you to visit their facility. It's a great facility. But in addition, this project will promote good forestry management practices by creating a substantial new market for low-grade wood. Developing a stable market for this wood is an issue that the New Hampshire Timberland Owners Association has been working on for years, and that is why they too are supportive of this project. But as I mentioned, it's not only the environment that is going to benefit. The local, regional, and state economies will have very positive impacts associated with this project. A recent economic study completed on this concept showed that upwards of $20 million will be injected into the New Hampshire economy. As Portsmouth's largest taxpayer, this investment will provide stability to the tax base so you can continue to support your city schools and fund important infrastructure needs, as you see. We will be creating hundreds of construction jobs, protecting timberland owner jobs, and maintaining our valued relationship with many of the local area businesses. And the beauty of this is that we're doing this all within an industrially zoned area of the city with minimal impact to the surrounding area. So how did we end up where we are? I'd like to take a few moments and go through what got us here and then go through the operational concepts of the project. About 18 months ago, we started looking at what role PSNH may be able to play in helping stabilize the low-grade wood market. We looked at everything from acquiring some of the developed existing wood-burning facilities. We looked at putting in a new facility ourselves, and we looked at some of our existing facilities and whether or not we could modify those. And because of the infrastructure that exists at Schiller, the highly trained employees in power generation utilizing solid fuel, and the size of our turbine generator units, we're all compatible to a wood-fired boiler. And as I mentioned, wood is renewable. It's an environmentally friendly fuel, and the 400,000 tons a year that we will be purchasing will provide that market stability, or help provide that market stability, to that will again help with the good forestry management practices. We are only burning clean wood. No demolition debris will be burned in this boiler. We will be primarily burning whole tree chips right from the timber industry, the timber operations right within the forest, right to our boiler. And as I mentioned, by doing so, we will recognize and achieve the benefits of significant emission reductions, as illustrated on this chart. And as I mentioned, additional to the environmental benefits that we will be realizing with this project, there are tremendous economic benefits that go with it. And that is very unusual that you have the two working hand in hand. As I mentioned, an economic study that was done will show that upwards of $20 million will be injected into the economy based on the 400,000 tons a year of fuel that we'll be purchasing. And all this can be done with keeping our customers cost neutral. And how we do that is, in addition to selling the electricity like we do today, we will be generating and selling renewable energy certificates in the states of Massachusetts and Connecticut. And it will be that revenue stream that will be used to pay for the investment of this project, thereby keeping our customers neutral, and surely with regard to the environment, the economy, and the customers, it's certainly a win-win-win. Chill Station, we currently have three operating units. They're 50 megawatt in size, and as I mentioned, these size units is very compatible to a single wood boiler that we'll be putting in, we'll talk about in just a minute. And it'll all be located within the boundaries of our 112-acre site. And within that site, this project will be located on already developed areas, so very little existing vegetation will be affected as a result of this construction. And as you will see on this slide here, we are in a pretty heavily industrialized zone along the Piscataquis River, surrounded by predominantly commercial and business areas. However, we do have residential areas, and we have been working with them, and we will continue to work with them and any other parties that have concerns or interests on what we will be doing with regards to this project. And I mentioned several of the supporters associated with this project. Here's a list of others. And again, it's one of those somewhat incredible stories that we have in environmental sector, we have the business sector, and we also have governmental sector that are all in support of this project. Now, the wood will predominantly be coming from, the northern New Hampshire or central New Hampshire area, as depicted in the dark green. And in terms of the travel, there'll be two main areas of routes to reach our site. And those areas we'll be discussing a little bit, but it'll be what I'll refer to as the 16 corridor and the 95-101 corridor. But as we talked about this project over the last several months, a year, rail has been brought up several times about its possible use for wood delivery. And the basic reason that rail does not fit for this phase of the project is one simply of logistics. If you could just picture, as an analogy, a coal mine being a single hole in the ground, if you will. They can bring rail cars right up to it. They can load those rail cars, and once they're loaded, they can send them off to their end user. It's a very efficient and effective way, and that's why it's the industry norm with many coal plants, including one of our coal plants here in New Hampshire. However, the timber industry, the wood chips, are basically small operations scattered throughout the region, many of which may only be in a single location for a couple weeks to maybe a couple months, so they move around. They literally bring these trucks into the forest and the woods with them, and they chip the wood and blow it right into the trucks, very similar to loading those rail cars. And when that truck is full, they want to send it to its end user. To bring in rail, then all these trucks would have to be sent to a central depot. They would have to be unloaded there, the wood would have to be loaded in the rail cars, and then the rail cars would have to come to the site, and then we'd have to have an infrastructure to unload those rail cars. That's not very efficient, and it's not feasible for this immediate project. And that's why it's not the industry norm to use rail. However, we are committed to continuing to view rail to the extent that we further expand the site for additional wood capability. And what we have done is two things. One is we convened a group consisting of the Rockingham Planning Commission, the Department of Transportation, Rail Bureau, the City of Portsmouth, the Town of Newington, Guilford Transportation, and ourselves to talk strictly about that subject, about the possibility of rail in the future. Because as we expand, should we expand the site in the future, our need for wood will expand further north into New Hampshire. And at that point, it may be more feasible to set up that depot so we can reach further north and further west in the state to get to the wood we need. And we also have hired a consultant to review this assessment and to help us better determine how we can feasibly use rail in the future should we expand our operations at Chiller Station. In terms of the traffic, again, another thing we have clearly heard is the concern with the 70 trucks a day that we've been saying are going to be required to deliver the wood. As you can see, we all realize that this area, the Gosling Road, Woodbury area, Little Bay Bridge, is a very existing, heavily congested area. On Gosling Road alone, there are 16,000 vehicles going up and down that main sector, what I refer to as the main sector, which is the section between Woodbury Ave and the Turnpike. We are talking 70 trucks a day, 140 trip ends. But we recognize that there is concern that they are trucks, and as a result, you will be hearing later about a traffic mitigation plan that we feel not only deals with the 140 trip end trucks, but also will incrementally assist with the current congestion that exists in that area. But what we've been doing with regards to talking about the 70 trucks a day, that has been somewhat of a conservative figure that we've been using. And in part of the discussion, as we've been talking about the 70 trucks a day, we've also talked about there's certain times of the year, namely, let's say, the mud season, where our deliveries will go down because the timber operations have to scale back because they can't get into the woods. And that prior to those seasons, namely the spring and the fall, we would have to build up our inventory. And so there's been questions about, well, how much over the 70 trucks are we going to go? So we want to answer that question. And we are anticipating burning 400,000 tons a year. That is the yellow line. And as you can see, as it's been laid out by our consultant, who has vast experience in the New Hampshire wood industry, and the wood deliveries, you can see that there is potentially no time of the year that we will actually trip over 70 deliveries a day. And we also illustrated to the extent that we should burn upwards of 450,000 times, more than 10% more than what we're expecting, that there are times during the year, primarily ahead of those mud season and those, you know, low delivery demand, low delivery seasons, there are times that we could get up as high as around 76 or 77 trucks. But as you can see, it's very few times a year. So I just want to illustrate that the 70 trucks a day that we've been utilizing, it was a very conservative number to, you know, make sure that we looked at things at a very reasonable level. But to make sure that the trucks are managed properly as part of the TAC process and as part of the Safety and Traffic Committee process, we have developed a truck management plan, and this has been reviewed and, to my knowledge, has been approved by the police department and the Department of Public Works. And basically, it is a plan that specifies the truck routes and the hours of operation for the truck drivers. It establishes some positive communication means with our wood suppliers. Each wood supplier is going to be required to designate someone as a traffic manager, and that will be the person we will directly speak to with regard to truck delivery issues. It requires training for the truck drivers, not only with regard to the plan, but from the from safety aspects as well. And there are significant penalties built in, not only for the truck drivers, but for our suppliers as well, in terms of them adhering to the requirements of the truck management plan. Well, let me just now talk about the what we're going to be doing on this project. This here is Schiller Station today, and that right there is Gosling Road. This is our existing cold pile area. This is that's the station down below there, and this area right here is what we refer to as the reserve cold pile area. The two large tanks to the right of the reserve cold pile area, what we refer to as the Newington fuel oil tanks. The two down below are the Schiller tanks, and the three up there to the left are the Sprague oil tanks that are located in our relative site. What we're going to be doing is installing a boiler with its associated facilities and a wood storage unloading facility. The boiler is going to be located down below on what we refer to as the south end of the plant, and the wood storage facility is up in this area here. And that is basically the site of the reserve coal pile area. This slide here is just depicting the basic process. You have that in your chart. It just basically depicts the process that we're going to just kind of go through one by one here with regards to when the truck arrives and how the wood flows through the process and ends up in the boiler. The first stop that the truck will make is at the coal scales. There'll be coal scales located up by those Newington tank area on the existing road. Right there, the trucks will come in and get weighed, and they will also weigh out on their way out as well. The trucks will then proceed to the truck dumps, which are located inside on the inside portion of the site, within the wood storage building. That's the wood storage building to its back. These truck dumps, as you can see, as it's illustrated, literally take the trucks and the lift. It's pretty impressive. Brings it up and dumps the wood into a hopper. From there, the wood is carried up the conveyor to the process building. The process building basically screens the wood and any wood that is too large for the boiler to handle is broken down further to a size, and then all the wood to the appropriate size, and all the wood is then carried to the wood storage building. We only anticipate about 5 or 10% of the wood needing to be resized. The majority of the wood should be of the correct size. This here is some of the other conveyors. That there is depicting outdoor storage. There's a conveyor that comes off the process building. We have the capability of storing 2 million cubic feet of wood on the site. The majority of that will be undercover, and that is what we intend to store. The majority of our wood is undercover for the benefits of making sure that there's no dust issues, but also it helps keep the wood dry. The wood already is going to show up 40 to 50% moisture because it's all freshly cut wood. We don't necessarily want to store it outdoors and let it absorb more moisture from an efficiency standpoint. But to the extent that we have to stockpile before those seasons that I mentioned earlier, that will be our outdoor storage area. And that conveyor right there is the main conveyor going down to the boiler. Oh, did I jump? Sorry. Keep going. This here is the boiler. There's the conveyor coming in right there. The boiler, again, is basically located in a developed area on the south end of our facility where there are already some existing structures and it's all paved. The boiler will be housed in an enclosure similar to the existing facility. The new stack that's depicted there will be basically in line with the other three stacks. It'll be of the same height. The existing stacks are approximately 8 foot in diameter. This stack will be approximately 10 foot in diameter. So it'll be a little fatter, but it'll be the same height and in the same general area as the existing three stacks. I mentioned about dust. Inherently, there's not a lot of dust associated with wood chips. These are whole tree chips that we'll be burning. I think you have samples there in front of you in the bags. But to the extent that there is dust, that is why we are going to be building an enclosure, and we are designing it with the building along the roadside, keeping it will be closed on three sides with the open side open toward the wood yard area. Yes?
How are you going to get your chips from the open stack into the enclosed building?
From the open...
You have chips stored in an enclosed building.
Yes.
You have...
Oh, the outdoor storage?
Outdoor storage. How
right.
are you going to move those chips from there to the inside?
We will be using a bucket loader, a rubber-tired bucket loader, to bring the wood from that location to a hopper that's located by the building that will bring it down to the boiler. And that's another reason that we... are going to minimize the amount of outdoor storage because it's more labor intensive for us to reclaim that wood.
Thank you.
And there have been questions about odors associated with burning wood. Really, when you walk into the building, it's going to smell like fresh cut wood, like Christmas trees, if you will. And we will be maintaining a first-in, first-out inventory concept. And the reason for that, actually, there's two reasons. One is you don't want the wood to sit any length of time. Because of all the moisture, it'll eventually start decaying and will create odors. But also from a fire protection standpoint, we worked with Deputy Chief Griswold and assured him as part of our inventory management plan that we will also not allow the chips to sit any length of time so that it can become dry enough to be potentially become a fire hazard. So that is the inventory process that we'll be following, and there's really no other odors associated with burning wood. With that, I'll turn it over to Attorney Chindella.
Just one quick question.
Sure.
And I understand everything you've said so far, but in the processing of the wood and the delivering of the wood, is there any treatment to get rid of the bugs and so forth and the... what are the bugs that chew wood?
Termites.
And so forth that come from the forest, bringing them into the city. How do you handle that process?
Let me turn to a consultant.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, this is Eric Kingsley from Innovative Resources.
Sorry,
Integrated.
Eric.
Good morning. Good evening. Eric Kingsley with Innovative Natural Resource Solutions. There are bug problems with whole tree chips. This is industry standard. There are no issues. And termites, which you brought up, are a problem for wood that sits in a house after 10, 15, 20 years. The pile here is 17 days. We're not going to be there nearly long enough to invite the termites in. But it's a non-issue.
I hope you're right.
I have significant experience. Other facilities around the country and around New England that burn whole tree chips do not have issues with bugs.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We're going to move to the next segment of our presentation. We're going to review the site review standards, and we're going to use the May 24th TAC conditional approval letter as a framework for our discussion. Mr. Desmonds is going to discuss fire protection, water and sewer, drainage and natural features, and along with Tom Gorrell and Terry Dewan, I'm going to address the remaining standards.
Hello again. Many of these fire protection items, you'll note we put TAC, obviously standing for the Technical Advisory Committee. These are items that they stipulated that we needed to make sure we adhere to in certain conditions, and so we identified those to let you know which ones of those were pertained to TAC. But as you can see, all the fire protection systems, for instance, the request to have all conveyor belts fire resistive have all been included in the design specification, the sprinkler system for the process building and so on. And we certainly are going to build this unit within all the appropriate building and fire codes, NFPA codes, et cetera. I mentioned about the pile management plan earlier. It's actually a component within the wood management plan that talks about the inventory management to make certain that the wood is not allowed to sit and become potentially combustible. And again, Deputy Fire Chief Griswold worked with us on a lot of these things. He spent a lot of time helping us go through this. And he has reviewed that plan and is satisfied with the components of that plan. And in addition, we're going to be expanding the water main in the area, not because of water needs, but strictly as a fire main, for the additional fire hydrants that will be installed and the associated sprinkler systems, et cetera. With regards to water system, as I just mentioned, there's not to be any, not anticipated to have any substantial increase of water demand over our existing site. We are retiring a boiler, so we are going to still end up with only three units. We have three operating units today. We're going to have three operating units tomorrow. And the same thing with regard to the sewage system as well.
Excuse me. We had a letter from the Public Works indicating that they recommended that Gosin Road be a 12-inch main from the street to the first tee location.
Right.
Are you familiar with that?
Yes.
Is that in fact going to take place?
Yes, there is going to be. I've just been made aware in the last couple of days of some correspondence with regards to the upgrading from 10-inch to 12-inch, and that is all pertaining to the new fire main that will be brought up a loop within the wood storage area to make sure that we have adequate supply for the fire hydrants and the fire protection systems.
Thank you.
With regards to the site drainage, as I've been mentioning, this project will be sited on areas that are already developed. The reserve coal pile area where the wood storage is going is the coal storage area is already paved, so the majority of that area is not going to be changed in terms of adding to impervious areas. And as the way our site slopes down, the majority of all runoff will cross through our property as it works its way down to the Piscataquis River, again, with minimal impact to any surrounding or abutting areas. And we have, again, created a stormwater maintenance plan, that has the maintenance schedules associated with all the proper erosion and stormwater requirements and techniques and maintenance, and has been reviewed by the Department of Public Works. With regard to natural features, again, I've been mentioning that the majority of the area has been previously developed, so there's very little, if any, trees or woody vegetation that is going to be impacted by this project. There are some small wetlands. I believe it's in the order of 2,300 square feet that would be impacted as a result of the entire project. Noise and flood hazards. We have designed this project right up front to keep noise or sound issues in the forefront. We have designed that all major machinery will be enclosed within buildings. The wood delivery trucks themselves have side opening doors that they actually fasten before the truck is lifted. It is not the standard construction type vehicles with the slapping tailgate, so there'll be no slapping tailgate noises or things of that nature. As I mentioned, the boiler will be enclosed again to really try to keep all sound-related issues confined. But in the end, our goal has been to not have any impacts to the ambient surrounding sound levels that exist, but we certainly will be meeting the city noise ordinance regulations as required, as set forth in the performance standards. And we have a sound consultant that has done some preliminary readings and is working with our manufacturers of the equipment to make sure that we design the appropriate facilities and mitigations into the initial design as before we build the unit.
Excuse me, I had a question.
Sure.
I believe I read something in the packet about the backing up alarm of the trucks, and was just sort of wondering if you could remind me about how that will work.
Well, the backup alarms with this design, what really makes this the overall layout desirable is, if you recall, we have the backup we have the truck dumps located behind the wood storage building. This wood storage building is going, it's 360 feet long, 175 feet wide, and 85 feet to the peak. So it will be clearly sheltered by the truck dumps are clearly sheltered by that building, and because that building will help attenuate a lot of the sound to the abutting areas. With regards to the flood hazard portion, the wood storage yard is located well above the 100-year base flood elevation, and the boiler, as I mentioned, on the south end of the plant is in the area where will maintain the existing grades so that the flood storage will not be reduced. I will turn it over to Attorney Chindella.
Very quickly, just as a prelude to discussion on the traffic issues, we, as an industrial site, we obviously have no school impact, and your pedestrian access site planning standard, you're going to hear that there are some pedestrian features to the immediate, to the traffic mitigation plan we're proposing. And what I want to do now is give you a, you're going to hear from Tom Gorrell in a minute, but I want to just begin to give you kind of a conceptual framework for how we've approached the traffic mitigation issue. We've tried to operate from a premise that we're going to deal in a way that we think is flexible and comprehensive and in an integrated fashion with both really the immediate, the intermediate, and the long-term traffic planning issues in the area of the development. We're going to fund an immediate traffic mitigation plan. We're going to provide initial funds for a traffic study as an intermediate element. And we're going to provide initial funds for a long-term traffic mitigation element. And we're also going to put into play, really put on the table, and really an essential element to a comprehensive long-term solution. And I'll give you the particulars on all this in a minute. But basically, we have two elements to our proposal. One is Gosling Road, and the other is Shattuck Way. We propose to pay to the city of Portsmouth approximately $1 million in traffic mitigation funds for improvements to be made to Gosling Way. And those funds will be used to complete the immediate improvements on Gosling Road. The balance of the funds are going to be used to study the impacts of extending Shattuck Way. And the remaining balance after those two things will be used to provide a base of funding for long-term infrastructure improvements on Gosling. You're going to hear in a minute from Tom Gorrell about what we're calling the immediate improvements on Gosling Road. There are six pieces to what Mr. Gorrell is going to tell you. One, there's a turning radius issue coming off of Spalding from exit 1 northbound off-ramp onto Gosling Road. The turning radius, it's an existing condition, but the turning radius needs to be improved. Two, we're going to construct an additional eastbound through lane at the intersection of Gosling and the Mall driveway, basically recover for the city of Portsmouth the left lane that was dedicated at some point previous as a left lane turn entry into the malls in Newington. So there'll be a through lane that'll be constructed to cure what Mr. Gorrell will describe as a lane drop problem. Three, we're going to relocate the existing diagonal crosswalk at the intersection of Gosling Road and the Mall driveway so that it's perpendicular to Gosling Road. And in addition, we're going to add a crosswalk to allow pedestrians to cross the Mall driveway parallel to Gosling Road. And these crosswalks will have pedestrian signals and will facilitate pedestrian crossing in that area. Four, we're going to optimize some traffic signal timing at the intersection of Woodbury and Gosling. Five, we're going to install a raised median in the area of Gosling immediately west of Woodbury to mitigate what we learned was the major traffic accident area location or locus in this area, involving left turning lanes into the gas stations that are at the corner there. And six, we're going to put in warning lights adjacent to the gymnastic facility. You continue past Woodbury Road toward the project east of Woodbury with appropriate pedestrian signage. So those are, Mr. Gorrell is going to give you a much more complete, but just to give you some headlines on those, that's what he's going to be talking about. Those are the six components or elements of what we're calling the immediate traffic improvements. The long-term improvements on Gosling are really in the nature of a major infrastructure improvement, a major corridor improvement. We've worked with the Department of Public Works, and Mr. Gorrell's firm has put on a traffic corridor plan those full infrastructure improvements for Gosling Road. And that's a part of the record. It's been part of the record before TAC. They include an overlay, which we did a geotechnical study, which revealed that the road would have to be resurfaced with or without this project. So these are things that really are in the nature of a major infrastructure improvement program. The second major element of our program, our traffic mitigation plan, is Shattuck Way. And here again, we're going to have a phased approach. We are going to, as part of our traffic mitigation proposal, dedicate across PSNH land in the town of Newington at Newington Station the right-of-way for the extension of Shattuck. And this is the putting the piece into play or on the table that will allow for a long-term comprehensive solution. We estimate the value of the real estate interest we're prepared to dedicate to be between $350,000 and $400,000 based on standard appraisal methods. It's a approximately 2.3-acre corridor that will go across Newington Station. And again, we think this, delivering this piece, we think will allow over time a fully modeled, comprehensive improvement for traffic in this area. And the city has, throughout this project, the city has been very consistent through its traffic director, through traffic and safety, about it saying repeatedly that the extension of Shattuck, the construction of the Shattuck extension, needs to be evaluated by the city of Portsmouth to determine what the traffic impacts of having traffic flow into Portsmouth from an extended Shattuck. So, again, this is a message that's been delivered consistently by the city throughout. So an element of our funding proposal is to provide a base of funds to allow for that study to take place so the impact in Portsmouth of the extension of Shattuck can be evaluated. In addition to dedicating the right-of-way to the town of Newington, the project is also prepared to pay to the town of Newington $275,000 over time to defray the costs of the town in constructing the extension of Shattuck Way. We have also committed to the city that we will, through the president of PNH, try to assist the city in bringing more funds to bear from other governmental subdivisions, or well, they're the divisions, I guess we're the subdivisions, but the state, the federal government, we've talked about, we are in the process actually of putting together a meeting with the Department of Transportation Commissioner. At that meeting, the City of Portsmouth, the Town of Newington, Rockingham Planning Commission, other interested parties will be brought in, and we're going to work very, very closely with the city as the lead in trying to see whether we can bring even more funds to bear on these issues. That is a summary of our, kind of an overview of our traffic mitigation proposal. You're going to hear next from Tom Gorrell of Gorrell and Palmer. He's going to describe for you more particularly what we're calling the immediate improvements to Gosling Road.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, or Madam Chairman, and members of the board. My name is Tom Gorrell. With the engineering firm of Gorrell Palmer. We were retained to complete a traffic impact study for this project. As was mentioned earlier, we're expecting the project, or we base our study on the project, to generate approximately 70 trucks per day to the site. And you can see from this graph that that Dick presented earlier, we have about 400,000 tons. We are never going to get to the 70, actually. We shouldn't get to the 70. So the 70 is a fairly conservative number, and as you can see, it varies with the time of year. Should you go to 450,000, then it does get a little above 70, gets up to 75, 77, something like that, trucks to the site per day. In terms of what that means in trip generation, the 70 truck loads per day are one-way trips. Those are trucks to the site. So they obviously need to leave the site as well. So that gets to be 140 truck trip ends. So a trip end is either an in or an out. Trip ends would be a round trip. We obviously know that trucks equate, they're different than cars, they equate to more than one car. So in terms of space, if we assume that one truck is equal to four passenger cars, In other words, one truck being four passenger car equivalents. Then we take the 140 and we multiply it by four, and we end up with 560 passenger car equivalents per day. By way of comparison, to get a sense for, you know, about how much traffic and such that is, a fast food restaurant in an hour during a peak hour can generate in the vicinity of 200 to 300 passenger car equivalents. That again is an hour, not a day. Obviously there's a fair amount of traffic, as Dick indicated, on the road today. If we use a benchmark for that of the portion of Gosling Road between Woodbury Ave and the mall, that's about 14,500 vehicles per day today. So if we take the 560 passenger car equivalents and divide it into that 14,500, which actually isn't passenger car equivalents because there's certainly a number of trucks in that 14,500. But if we did that, that comes out to about a 3.9% increase. So we'll be running from about 14,500 to just over 15,000 vehicles per day.
Excuse me, I have another question. I was wondering what the, I guess, sort of traffic rate, number of trucks going into the coal burning facility are now. What is it, burner number 5? And what the, so therefore what the change will be up to 7-day trucks. I mean, obviously most of the material is coming in on rail, but are there any, you know, is there any coal coming in on trucks?
Well, for the, I'll let Dick answer that in a second, but I would say for the purpose of our study that we did, the traffic impact study, we assumed that the 70 trucks per day was all new traffic. We didn't make a subtraction. But there actually, that's another reason it's a conservative number.
Yeah, Madam Chairman, just to clarify, we bring in our coal by ship. And we have no rail facilities except for the fact that the rail goes through our property. So there are no truck deliveries associated with the unit, so there will be no net balancing out.
Thanks.
Could I ask you one further question? Do you have any long-range plans in public service to add additional wood chip burners in the out years?
Not at this time, no.
Because that's going to have an awful lot of difference with the trip ends and the traffic plans and everything else, and I was just wondering what your plans are for the next 30 to 50 years.
The as I mentioned earlier, right now there's no plans, as I mentioned, for any future expansion with regard to wood. However, we are having discussions. We have a rail consultant on board, along with the Rockingham Planning Commission, the Department of Transportation Rail Bureau, the City of Portsmouth, the Town of Newington, Guilford Transportation, and us, that are already having discussions. To the extent that we do decide to expand, then we are looking at ways that we can make rail more feasible for that type of expansion because of the concern with trucks.
You can understand why I asked the question that I asked.
I can.
Okay, thank you.
I have a question. I don't know which one of you is best to answer this, but are the truck trips evenly spaced during the day, or are they going to have their own peak period? And also, any given truck coming to the site, what's its general duration of stay on the site?
Certainly, again, going back to the way these operations work, you know, these operations are going on throughout the day, and when the truck is filled, they send it off. So we would expect that for the most part, you know, it's not going to be certainly not evenly spaced, but it is certainly during the hours of 7 a.m. to 9 p.m., which is our hours of operation, we would expect them to be relatively, you know, spread out through that time. In terms of the amount of time that they spend on the site, They will come in and they will scale through, which is just a matter of minutes. And we have specified three truck dumps for the purpose of not to alleviate any queuing concerns. Each dump process will take approximately 20, maybe 25 minutes, so we can accommodate about three trucks, maybe four trucks in an hour. No, actually, it's even more than that. That's right. It would be three trucks every 20 minutes, roughly, so times three is about nine trucks an hour.
Thanks.
Well, this slide, I guess, to be honest, didn't come out quite as well as I was hoping it would. But let me briefly describe the off-site improvements to you. What is shown on this slide is Gosling Road. This would be the McDonald's driveway. This is the driveway to the mall. This would be the exit one Spalding Turnpike off-ramp. This interchange, there's Spalding Turnpike, is located approximately three-quarters of a mile from the plant, which is to our east, just off the sheet here. Well, more than off the sheet. Woodbury Avenue is off the sheet, but we'll get to that in a second. Just off to the right. The improvements that Rob talked about, I'd like to go through with you in a little bit of detail. Right now, the first improvement being a radius that he referred to as you're coming off the northbound off-ramp onto Woodbury Avenue. That would be this movement here. Currently, that movement cannot accommodate a tractor-trailer truck and have them stay in their own lane the entire way. That's obviously an interstate ramp. It's an existing condition. You do have trucks doing this today, but that's an existing deficiency. They actually sort of swing a little bit when they come off, perhaps into the adjacent lane, and swing a little wide and then wind back in. So what we're proposing to do is to complete a improvement, a widening, if you will, of that radius so that the truck can complete that turning movement in its own lane. That improvement can be accomplished within the existing right-of-way. The second improvement that we'd be looking at, and that's what's a little hard to see here, but when you come, as you're traveling east on Gosling, what happens is you have two lanes approximately here that are you think are through lanes, and then all of a sudden you seem to be in a left turn lane. It's really a lane drop, and that's not really ideal. Certainly from a safety standpoint, because people that didn't want to be in that left turn lane, that might be new, not familiar with the area, are going to then want to weave to the right to get into the one through lane that remains. When that happens, that can create a safety concern. So for that reason, we're looking at constructing an additional lane to allow for two through lanes, and constructing it in a way that you don't end up in a left turn lane when you come off that exit or are traveling through. So that's going to be a significant improvement, and I should certainly talk about John Burke and Steve Parkinson. They've been great to work with and have identified some of these issues as well. So they've been very helpful. Our third, and that lane drop issue in terms of the construction of the lane, which really is the roadway construction will run from about here down to just past the mall driveway. Again, this is an immediate improvement. Can be constructed within the existing right-of-way based on the information, the right-of-way information that we've received from the city. The crosswalks, right now, at the mall driveway on Gosling, there's a diagonal crosswalk. It goes something like this. Diagonal crosswalks aren't really ideal. that's how people generally are walking across there, and it may not be striped at this point, but you don't want to be doing that, because what we have are two left turn lanes here that turn into the mall. So we want to keep the pedestrians over on this side so that they don't really conflict if they want to cross Woodbury Avenue. So what they will be doing is walking to this crosswalk here, just on the east side of the mall driveway, and then they can also, as was suggested by the Traffic Safety Committee, that they want certainly another crosswalk across here, which is protected a little bit in the middle by the island, so that they could cross to McDonald's. There would be a pedestrian crossing lights installed there. We are also taking the sidewalk, because we don't want to cross them there and then not put them anywhere. We're going to take the sidewalk and extend it into about that location in the mall, provided we can certainly have permission to do that. The next improvement, if I could have the next slide.
Before you move on, could I ask a question?
Yes.
Had you considered putting a crosswalk further down near the Goslin Meadows housing project? There's an awful lot of traffic for people in there that walk, that go from there to the mall, and not necessarily over to McDonald's and to the other establishments, but they go back and forth. They carry groceries in carts. A number of years ago, we had a discussion on a previous project where it was suggested that there'd be an overhead bridge. I don't think that is probably the best method of getting people over there, but you have a high density of people in Gosling Meadows, and it would seem to me if they crossed directly across Gosling Road rather than traveling up Gosling Road and then crossing where you're putting that walkway, you know, I don't know if this has come up in your discussion or not.
I think that's a good question, because, you know, pedestrians typically like to take the shortest path. There's no question about that. And we have worked closely, as I mentioned, with the Public Works and John Burke, as well as the Traffic Safety Committee. The concern with what that direct path the pedestrian might like to take is that it's a mid-block location, and by that I mean it's uncontrolled. It would be crossing essentially four lanes of traffic, and that's really without any protection in the middle of the roadway. That's difficult to have four lanes stop. By having it here and by moving it to where we have shown it, we've minimized the vehicular pedestrian conflict. First of all, we have all those lefts that go in there not conflicting with the crosswalk, and we have it controlled by a traffic signal, so that the pedestrians can cross when they don't have to cross against a major movement like that. In addition, driver expectation is not for mid-block crosswalks. You have a lot more potential for collisions, which obviously are devastating at that point. So we believe this is much safer to have them come to this point, and if they need to backtrack at some point, then that would be a much safer move for them to make.
Fine, and I had one other question. Going westward from your station on Gosling Road, is the ramp, a right-hand ramp, just taking those trucks up onto the Spalding Turnpike, is that going to have to be modified? And if you go underneath the Spalding Turnpike and you make a left-hand turn down towards the circle, does that ramp have to be modified for those 10-wheelers to make those turns?
That's not something that we've observed as an issue, and that's not an issue that that has been brought up, certainly by city staff, who's pretty familiar with that, or the turnpike. We've been talking with them as well. So those movements, as we've shown here, and especially with the angle, they should be able to occur. And the left-hand turn certainly is not an issue, because they've got more room to align. They've got the road width to align. The typical one that's a problem is this type of movement, because it tends to be a little bit more acute. You know, you're almost at an angle, if you will, when you're trying to make that movement.
You may want to take a look at that, and the one on the other side too, because That ramp there narrows down as you get close to Spalding Turnpike. And you've got left-hand traffic coming out of the Pease Development Authority facility and off from the highway, and with your trucks making that turn, I see a potential problem, and I only bring it up because I think you people are the experts, and you should be taking a look at this.
Yeah, we did. In fact, we followed trucks through there just to see how they're kind of tracking, and I haven't seen an issue with any truck. We did certainly see this issue.
Thank you.
You're welcome. If I could have the next slide. Thank you. The next improvement was certainly requested that we review the accident history at the intersection of Gosling, which is running this way, and Woodbury, which is running this way. This is the mobile station. The plant is down in this direction. This intersection was requested that we compile the collision information for that intersection. And what we found was, in the last 3 years or so, there have been 74 collisions at that intersection. We took each one of those collisions and put them on one diagram, so each collision report we drew. And when you do that, what ends up happening is you find a lot of them, 39 to be exact, were actually happening that involved left turns in and left turns out of the mobile driveways. So, you know, a little more than half. There is a way to correct that that's certainly within the right-of-way that we had suggested, and it seems to be something that city staff has concurred with, and that is to put an island across here. This, again, is Gosling. This is Woodbury. The plant's down here. We would install a raised island across here, which would, in effect, prohibit those left turns. That clearly is going to solve about 39 accidents. So that's why we recommend it. Recommend that, you know, whether the plant was moving forward or not, we do a lot of corridor studies for municipalities. That's probably something we would recommend. You don't do that lightly because it is a business. It does take away some of their movements, and you need to sort of retrain people. But it is a clear safety concern when you have 39 collisions. Another improvement that we were requested to make that has been incorporated into the plan, the Traffic and Safety Committee requested it, was to install no parking signs along Gosling so that we don't end up with trucks parked for some reason to go into McDonald's or something, I guess, may happen today. So that was requested that we do that. Also, we are going to optimize the traffic signal at this intersection of Gosling and Woodbury. And finally, on further down Gosling here, we are going to be installing flashing pedestrian signs adjacent to the gymnastic facility, basically on either side of that, so that people are aware that there may be an increased level of pedestrian traffic at that in that area. That's a summary of the immediate plans, which, as Rob indicated, would be funded here immediately and done right away. In terms of the long-term improvements, I think you went over that. We do have that plan. It's a roll plan that pretty much probably would go from that corner to that corner if we rolled it out. It's a long plan. It features a sidewalk on Gosling on the north side of the road, so another pedestrian feature, if you will, going up this side. It features an overlay, which would need to be done anyway, according to our geotechnical consultant, in, I think it's a 7-year time frame. And it also features widening Woodbury Gosling from Woodbury down to the railroad tracks. In summary, there are other little things on that plan, but that's the summary of the major features of that plan. That concludes the traffic.
Very quickly, before turning it over to Terry Dewan, I want to touch on a couple of points that are in this slide. We're crowding our 75 minutes here, and Just a couple of points. You've heard about the truck management plan. It has been revised since the meeting of TAC on May 20th, and Deputy Chief Young has approved it, and Mr. Burke has approved it as well. So the truck management plan is in place. We've agreed also to share with the city attorney and get his input on the contractual language that would be really the enforcement mechanism on the truck routing, so we'll be doing that as well. And then finally, the bullet that relates to, I believe it's the next slide, the bullet that relates to rail, just to pick up on Mr. Sullivan's point, I think the fundamental here in terms of rail is that PSNH, as part of this project, has established a process, and the business of that process is to study rail and to be ready to move rail into a more everybody's central vision as a future item. So certainly your question was right on the money in terms of future development on the site, and this process that we're establishing is the appropriate thing to do to bring rail into the picture. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Dewan.
Madam Chairman, members of the Planning Board, my name is Terry Dewan. I'm a landscape architect from Yarmouth, Maine. And our firm was asked to look at some of the issues related to the facility and how it relates to the immediate neighborhood. And what we'd like to do is to go through a series of slides that look at the context and some of the neighborhood considerations, and then examine what it was going to look like, what it will look like from these various viewpoints. This is the viewpoint map. We'll use this as a context. This doesn't seem to be working. Oh, there. Okay. There's the PSNH facility on the top of the diagram right here. We've looked at four different commercial and residential neighborhoods: the neighborhood around Commerce Way, the neighborhood around Osprey Landing, the historic Atlantic Heights neighborhood, the Oriental Gardens Mobile Home Park, and then the Gosling Meadows that Tom was just talking about. And we're going to go through and examine each one of these in a little bit more detail. First of all, let's start at Commerce Way. And this is the closest neighborhood, if you want to call it that, to the facility. We have a series of commercial buildings, mostly one-story, with the exception of the one three-story building right here, which are between 630 and 720 feet to the wood storage facility. This is a pretty typical illustration driving along Commerce Way right now. This is looking at the Sprague tanks. This is a view from the third floor of the Newmark International building on Commerce Way. And this is one of the closest points of contact, visual contact, between the wood storage facility and the people that work in the immediate vicinity. Now, the slide looks a little bit off, and that's because on the inside of the glass from this particular office suite, they had put a layer of plastic film, supposedly to cut down on the glare from the outside. So it's not the quality of the photograph. This is the way the view actually looks from this particular viewpoint. Working with the architects developing a computer model, we found that the proposed wood storage facility and the other facilities will look like this. And in looking at what could be done in terms of mitigation, we proposed a number of things. Let me go back a moment here. Again, here we are looking at the oil storage facilities in the background there. We knew that with the addition of the wood storage facility, we wanted to do something to help offset the views. And again, in working cooperatively with the people that own the office buildings here, we came up with the idea of establishing a 24-foot high noise barrier or screening wall on top of a 10-foot high earth berm, a landscape berm that you can see on the left side of the photograph right here. This is 24-foot high, running 420 feet in length. At one point then, it will step down to 10 feet high, where it goes underneath a power transmission line here. The net effect was going to be almost impossible to screen the view of the wood storage facility, but the effect, though, is to remove the view of the oil storage tanks. we feel it's certainly a way of mitigating the view and certainly improving the view by simplifying the view of the oil storage facility. The same view from the same office building at Newmark International, looking a little bit more to the northeast here. Again, you see different types of tanks. The Sprague tanks are off on the right at this particular vantage point. This is what it would look like in the future. Again, you can see the effect of the 24-foot high screening wall on the top left here. Now, in going through the various options for the construction design of the building, it's obvious that there's a number of different colors and forms for the building. The form was selected because it seems to be the most sympathetic to other typical forms in the area. We do have some flexibility in looking at the color of the building. We're showing here a sort of a reddish-brown color. We're also looking at what you might call a light ivy or a tan color, both of which are somewhat complementary to the other industrial structures in the area. And as we go through the process of working through the final decision, we'll be consulting with the people that have property along Commerce Way as part of this cooperative movement to come up with an agreeable solution. We then looked at the area around Osprey Landing. This is a fairly new residential development made up of multiplex and single-family homes in the immediate vicinity. Again, we're looking at homes that are between 1,300 and 1,900 feet away. On the diagram right here, we're showing particular viewpoints that we'll be looking at in the next couple of slides. And we've had, again, a couple of photo simulations to show what it will look like from these particular viewpoints. Here we are at Osprey Landing and Dunlin Way. Let me slide back here. This viewpoint is taken down here. Again, looking along Dunlin Way here, looking towards the plant. Now we're going to scroll through and see a few other typical shots on Blue Heron Drive. This shows the effectiveness of an existing hill that separates the entire residential development from the industrial facilities on the other side of the hill. This will not be affected. This is the community building within the interior of Osprey Landing. Again, because of the vegetation, the landforms, there's going to be no visual contact at this point. Here we have a small park, so the focal point right below the community building off of Shearwater Drive. At this point, you can start to see some of the commercial buildings in the background. They're already present as part of the view. And again, you can see one of the oil storage tanks in the background here. This is the first photo simulation at the intersection of Portsmouth Boulevard and Dunlin Way. The single-family homes are immediately behind us. This is not part of the residential development. Will probably at some point in the future be converted to some other type of commercial use. But at this point, with the addition to the facility that's under consideration now, this is what the facility will look like. The illustrations here show that the top of the wood storage building at 85 feet, the process building, the conveyor building, a conveyor over here. This is the existing Lewiston stack right now. We're adding one new stack right there, and these are the three existing stacks. So again, switching before, this is what it looks like today. This is what it looks like, will look like in the future. Again, we have the consideration of looking at the reddish color or a tan color. Again, going back to Dunlin Way, this time we're a little bit closer than the first slide. In the background, you can just barely see the form of the wood storage building. In profile, it's somewhat repetitious of the peak roofs of the single-family homes that you find in the immediate neighborhood. Again, the difference between the red and the tan color, the tan somewhat a little bit more sympathetic to the homes in the immediate vicinity. Not be an overwhelming presence to the neighborhood. There are a couple of points in contact with the multiplex units. Again, through the trees and some additional pines have been planted when this group of buildings were constructed. These photographs were taken about a month and a half ago, just after leaves started to come out. You can just barely see the facility in the red color, or if you have to use your imagination, in the lighter color. So in summary, there seems to be very little point of contact throughout most of the Osprey Landing development. If you go over to Atlantic Heights, a little bit farther away, a little bit less than half a mile. And here we are. We drove all through the neighborhood. We looked at points of contact. For the most part, it's a very inwardly focused neighborhood. There's one point, and we go back, and that's this point right here, where it may be possible, looking through the tree line right here, at a distance of a little over half a mile, you might be able to see the facility. But from our vantage point, you're really going to have to strain to see it through the trees. And again, most of the homes in the area are facing inwardly toward the interior streets. There's one point of contact on the railroad overpass in Kearsarge Way going into Atlantic Heights, where it may be possible to see the wood storage building during the wintertime through the screen of trees over there. Again, you're going to be looking through a chain link fence driving over the railroad pass. The next point we looked at was Oriental Gardens, a very well landscaped mobile home park just off of Gosling and Woodbury. And again, these photographs were taken about a month ago, and our conclusion after driving the entire area was that the wonderful vegetation that's out there is going to screen any view that you would have from any of the points within Oriental Gardens. Someone suggested that we take a look at the gymnastics studio on Gosling Road. There may be a point of contact as you drive up Gosling Road where you might be able to see the wood storage facility through the screen on the other side of the building here. It would be a very intermittent view, and we don't think it's going to be one that's going to affect anybody who goes to the gymnastics studio to exercise or to work out. The backside might have a little bit more view, but again, this is not a particularly outdoor use area, but the parking area and the dumpster back there. We don't think it's going to be much of a concern. The last area that we looked at were the homes on Gosling Meadows on the other side of Woodbury. Again, looking throughout the interior of the site, driving the neighborhood, the homes that are closest to Woodbury on Wheeled Road are already separated by a wooden fence in many places. They back up against commercial developments, gas stations in this case right here. The views are very limited. And are limited to looking at the backside of the commercial buildings, and it doesn't seem that you're going to have any contact with the facility. And the only other place that we looked at that may have any contact would be in back of the office on Wedgwood Road, and there may be a slight possibility to see the top of the wood storage building over the tops of the trees. So our conclusion was that while it may be visible from a few selected points, it's not going to have a major impact on the residential neighborhoods in the area, and on the commercial areas, we are taking steps to mitigate the visual impact by the construction of the wall. People have asked about the maintenance of this wall, the noise barrier. We have not designed it yet or selected a material. It would probably either be wood or a composite of wood and recycled plastic. If it is a wood material, the maintenance would involve looking at a water seal treatment to seal it every 4 to 5 years, doing the necessary tightening, replacement if any sections get damaged. If it is either one of those materials, it probably not need to be painted or stained, and doing whatever vegetation management is required. So that, in summary, is the conclusion that we've made on the visual screening. Any questions?
Oh, I guess not. Thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Madam Chairman, members of the board, before I move to our closing on this, just want to touch on a couple of brief points. One, Mr. Gorrell came up to me during the Mr. DeWan's presentation. He wanted to make it clear for the record that in response to your question, Mr. Sullivan, that the study that had been done of the truck movements on those other ramps was done by a computer modeling program and not by actual observations, just so we're accurate in the record. Second, we have a couple of slides which put into some context what Mr. DeWan has shown you. The first slide shows what's been done by the project to respond to issues that were raised by residential abutters at the May 4th Zoning Board hearing. And then the next slide is going to show you what the historical context for that is, and you'll see that what's happened here is there's been really a pretty robust and sustained effort on the part of PSNH to work with the immediate residential neighbors. And then the next slide just shows you that these are efforts that PSNH is committed to continuing with. I'm going to close now. What I'm going to do, I'm going to try to, there's been a lot of process before you, and I'm not going to restate things that have been said at the process below. I'm going to really do this in the order, in the nature of a summing up. I'll start with this, that there are two really, we think, very compelling reasons why this project should be approved by your board. One, this project's good for the city because it significantly reduces emissions and enhances air quality in the city. And two, it sustains the operation of this facility, of the Schiller plant, and thereby secures an important component of the tax base of the city going forward. And we think as well the project is good from a planning perspective. This is an area that, as you know, is zoned for industrial use. This property has been used continuously as an energy generation facility since the late 1940s. The approval of the site plan before you is consistent with the zoning of the city, and it's consistent with the purposes of the master plan. I know you're working on the master plan now, but if you look at the existing master plan, it talks about expanding the economic base of the city by concentrating primarily on the industrial areas of the city. And this project will sustain and prolong the life of a facility that's one of your key, if not what's the largest taxpayer in the city, but a key component of your industrial base. And this type of development will promote high-paying jobs going forward. So in three basic levels, we think the project is very good for the city. It enhances air quality, it sustains the stability of the tax base going forward, and it's fundamentally consistent with your zoning and your master plan. Now, among the key areas that have been raised by the city as we've gone through the process, we've obviously tried to be responsive at every level. We focused on traffic and land and screening issues. On the traffic issues, we think we have, you heard our presentation on the traffic mitigation plan, we think we have a proposal that meets the immediate, intermediate, and long-term needs and interests really associated with this area. And we have a truck management plan, which has been vetted by TAC, and we think does the job as well. And you just heard from Mr. DeWan describing our screening effort. We've worked very hard throughout the process to be responsive, not just to the city, its staff, and the boards we've been before, but to the concerns of abutters and other people who are proximate to the development. And that's a culture, really, of PSNH that's going to continue going forward. The proposal we put forward, we believe, meets the site review standards of the city. On fire protection, we've incorporated the conditions of TAC. We've taken steps to include appropriate sprinkler devices. We've produced a pile management plan to minimize fire hazard. On water and sewage, again, we've incorporated the conditions of TAC. We've incorporated recent revisions to the utility layout scheme. On site drainage and erosion control, again, we've provided studies to TAC. Those studies have been approved. We've made revisions to the studies where called for by TAC. On natural features, we have no impact on the river. Any filling of wetlands is pursuant to a DES permit. There's no significant change to the hilltop that's visible from areas in the city. On noise, we're going to be complying with the performance standard, part of your zoning ordinance. We've taken care in trying to, as Mr. Despin said, try to organize the layout of the site so that we use the sound attenuating features of the buildings to help with noise. On flood hazard, you heard Mr. Despin say that we're well above the 100-year base of flood elevation. School is not an issue. We're industrial. Pedestrian access internal to the site is not an issue. It's not a site that's accessible. On vehicular circulation, we've tried to work very hard with the city, with DOT, with Rockingham Planning Commission, with the town of Newington to ensure safety on and off the site, but as I said before, really put into place something that's going to help all the interested parties going forward.
on screening and landscaping. You've heard or seen the presentation by Mr. Dewan. We think we meet the standard of the city in that regard. So in final closing, we believe we meet the evaluation criteria and we comply with the city. We've complied with the city's ordinances and codes in all respect. We comply as to water, sewer, fire protection, drainage, protection for neighbors, landscaping, and traffic. And I guess the final thing I'll say is that this is in our view, one of those projects that it's a very good project in a macro sense, and it's also a very good project in a micro sense in terms of how good it is for the city. And we've worked very hard to mitigate any adverse impacts on our immediate surrounding neighbors. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anyone have any questions? Yes.
Bob, before you sit down, I guess I can lay this one on you. As this project has a wide-reaching effect within the state of New Hampshire, has the Public Service Company of New Hampshire done their homework with the towns of Exeter and the surrounding communities where these trucks are going to be picking up the chips and bringing them through those communities to get to ours?
The project it's a regional impact project. So we began this process one of the first things we did is to go to the Regional Planning Commission and meet with the Regional Impact Committee, and we've worked with them throughout the process. They've been a part of it. Obviously a component of the process for us has been the Public Utilities Commission, which has a statewide perspective as well. But the mechanism for doing just what you say is the declaration of it as a regional impact project and to work with the Regional Impact Committee of Rockingham Planning Commission, and we've done that.
Okay. One other question I had, Bob, and that was when I first read your executive summary in the booklet, first of 20 pounds here, I noticed that you talked about waste and ash. But then when I went, it took me down to page 32, and page 32 took me to attachment 43, and I still don't know how you're going to remove the ash from the site and what you're going to do with it.
I think Mr. Despens can answer that.
The ash is going to be collected in a silo that's actually physically located between the boiler building and the bag house, which is the emission control device. We will be trucking the ash off the site. The good thing with wood ash is it can be used in the agricultural sector. And so we, like we do with our coal ash, will pursue all recycling opportunities with the ash as opposed to just landfilling.
Okay. And I had one other...
Excuse me, could I follow up on that?
Yes.
I guess I'm just wondering if you can talk a little bit more about how the wood ash and the coal ash, if that's relevant, will be removed from the site. Will they go out on the same trucks on which the wood came in?
No, they will not be on the same trucks. We take our coal ash right now by truck off the site, and the wood ash would be in the same the same manner.
So is that no additional trips then? Is it a net?
It's actually a net reduction from today.
Thank you.
Okay, if I can follow up on my questions.
For you?
I'd rather talk to you right now. You mentioned in your presentation that you're going to have 400,000 tons of chips brought in a day.
Yes.
And I...
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, thank you. 400,000 tons a year.
Tons a year, okay. Can you tell me, and I imagine you've done your homework on this, you know, how many trees are we talking about? And does the New Hampshire Forest Program have adequate resources without leveling forests to take care of your needs? And especially as you, in the out years, no doubt you might be changing boilers and increasing that 400,000 out.
I may ask, if you want more detail, to have one of the experts get up here, but I will say that New Hampshire is the second most forested state in the nation, and we grow more wood than we harvest each year. So there is plenty of wood out there. And this is the wood, the whole tree chips that we would be burning will be coming from what is referred to as the low-grade wood. It's the branches, the tops of trees, you know, things of that nature. And as I mentioned, we are looking to promote good forestry management practices, and that is where we want to get our wood from. We are not necessarily, you know, looking to have areas clear-cut to just supply our wood.
That probably answers my question, but I have another question.
If I could just direct you to the slide, you can see the slide they brought up there. It was, you know, an eye-opener for me that that just gives us a relative sense of how forested this state is, even in our location here in Rockingham County.
But, you know, on the other hand, and it has nothing to do with this presentation, that's why New Hampshire is so great, is because we're so green, and many people want to keep it green. And that's why I asked some of the questions that I asked about harvesting of timber and pulp and things of this nature.
Well, again, I would just refer to the fact that the Society for the Protection of New Hampshire Forests, the New Hampshire Timberland Owners Association, along with New Hampshire Audubon Society, have all endorsed this project.
That surprised me in the readings.
Yeah, and you know, certainly the Society in particular is very much focused on preserving the forests in this great state.
And I have one other question that has probably more to do with you than anybody else. But, you know, in this community and other communities, we have, in the residential areas, we have a lot of trees that are being taken down. And I have had three on my property taken down, and I've asked the person that took them down, what do you do with the trunk? And they dispose of them wherever they can. Is this anything that you would be looking forward for these tree surgeons and so forth to bringing you the heavy timbers that most towns cannot handle?
Well, we will not have the ability to chip.
No chipping on the site?
No. The only thing is, as I referred to, is within the process building, there will be a grinder, if you will, that will take the whole tree chips that are oversized and bring them down, but we will not have a chipping operation on site that would be able to deal with branches or trunks of trees.
I didn't know that I could get you into the wholesale retail business. Thank you. If I could ask one, did you want to follow up on that or not?
No, you're on a roll, John.
I've read the material and I want my tongue. if I could, I'd like to ask John Burke, who is our city representative on the traffic, if he would answer a couple of questions relating to the westward movement of the trucks around the Spalding Turnpike, John. And I know that you've spent many hours in discussion, and you're far more intelligent and knowledgeable than I am on the subject. John, I'm concerned about coming out Goslin Road and making a right-hand turn up onto the Spalding Turnpike for the trucks, especially where it turns and where it narrows. And going underneath the bridge and making a left-hand turn, there's two lanes that turn left going down Spalding Turnpike towards the traffic circle. And that road turns into one lane before it hits the Spalding Turnpike, too. And I'm concerned that we've got some problems that might be developing here. And I'd like your opinion on the crossing of the people going into the mall from Gosling Meadows.
Yeah, a couple, few things there, but the Gosling Meadows issue, I completely concur with the traffic engineer on that. That mid-block crossings are no longer things that anybody's doing at those speeds. You would have to fully signalize and interconnect with the other two, and it, you know, it's not warranted. But I think this traffic pedestrian improvement's a good one because it's going to bring better sidewalks down and it'll be more convenient for them. There's no perfect. And it's never going to be convenient enough, but I think it's a good solution. The right turn onto the Spalding going north, is that the other one of the other issues? We did meet with DOT Bureau Turnpikes, and they did not see that as an issue. I know what you're referring to, and it's not ideal. They're working hard on some interchange improvements connected with the Little Bay Bridges, and I know that's off a little bit, but that will be, they'll be creating potentially another exit just north of exit one that's going to really take the heat off that particular double left turn. In fact, those volumes will drop significantly. Should be another entrance into Pease. But that wasn't really raised. We can talk to them again about that merging. It's whether or not the length of that merge is long enough. We can take another look at that certainly. If we need
right
to.
Now, it's a race to get up to the Spalding Turnpike with two lanes turning into it and so forth. And I'm concerned with these large trucks. Of course, they rule the road.
Yeah. These particular interchanges, Tom could probably talk to it better than I could, but these double left turns onto interchange ramps are not what you typically want a diamond interchange and some other types of interchanges that operate better than them. But that's what we got. We got double lefts, and so you have to merge them. It's not ideal, but it's what we were handed.
Thank you, John.
Yeah.
And I'm Chairman, I'm through.
Thank you. Okay, sure. Go ahead.
I don't know. This is a question for Rob or Dick, but am I correct in thinking for the record that the short-term improvements for Gosling Road require no takings? Everything that's proposed for improvements is within the right-of-way?
Tom can answer this in greater detail if you require, but we received right-of-way information from the city of Portsmouth, and based on that information, all the property required for in that lane drop area, and all those, which is the area, I think, that the only, correct me if I'm wrong, Tom, but I think that's the only area where that question was even in play or implicated, all those improvements can be made within the right-of-way. There's some shifting involved, and some of the right-of-way is it's the public right-of-way on the Newington side, but that's the answer to your question, Tom, unless you want to leave that part it.
You may be referring to the earlier submission we showed where we did look like we needed some right-of-way. We had since redesigned that to move it and shift it back in our latter submission. So, no, we don't.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Jerry, George, any questions?
Yes, I have a question for somebody. As I understand it, we're going to get half the wood chips from up north, and the other half are going to be traveling down from Maine or coming in from Massachusetts onto 95?
Basically, the half-and-half issue that has been raised is basically been focused more in terms of the delivery with the trucks. There's a slide in the presentation early on that shows that the darker green segment, we expect half of the wood to come from the general area of the Route 16 corridor, if you will, and then the other sector from the central part of the state. And in terms of the mode of the routes taken, I just refer to it as approximately half of the wood will be coming from that 16 corridor, so they'll be coming down the Spalding to Little Bay Bridge. And the other section there around the Manchester Concord, that dark green area, would probably be coming from the 101 to 95 corridor and approaching the site from that direction.
Right. Well, I don't know, but I could see a big mess. As you've got trucks coming down from up north, turning onto Goslin, and you've got trucks coming up Spalding, heading north and taking that turn onto Goslin, you got an awful lot of trucks coming in from two different sources, and I think I don't think we've done enough.
Yeah, again,
mitigation.
Yeah, I'll just say that again. We're talking 70 trucks over a 14-hour period. We anticipate somewhere around five trucks.
I know,
an hour.
How can you time it so you only have one at a time on Goslin Road, or are they going to be stacking up? Pretty hard thing to do. But they're coming from different sources.
Right, and they are just going to keep. They will just be a part of the 16,000 vehicles that are currently going up and down Goslin Road, including already trucks from the commercial areas as well that are part of that 16,000 vehicles a day.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Just one question. David, have all the stipulations on your planning department memorandum been complied with or are in the process of being complied with?
Yes, they are, and I can speak to that when we get to the point of further discussion. But I would just state that there's general agreement on the improvements. There are general agreements on the amounts of money. There are general agreements with the town of Newington and also with all the other parties. It probably would be useful if Attorney Ciandella went over again what the contributions are and the fashion that they'll be produced, but yes, they are.
Thank you.
Thanks. Any other thoughts? No. Okay. Do we have any other speakers? Two for or against? Please state your name.
For the record, my name is Raymond Will. I serve on the Portsmouth Planning Board, but I've recused myself this evening as I am also an abutter and a member of the Atlantic Heights Neighborhood Association. While I am not speaking for either body this evening, I'm only speaking for myself as a resident of 125 Preble Way. I came in with five questions. One was eliminated, and John touched on number four. So let me see if I can go through each of these. One of them is very short, but the other ones may require some discussion, so I hope you bear with me as I go. The first is very short. Will PSNH be using any coal burners after the project? Assuming this project is approved, will they be using any coal burners at all on site?
Yes, we currently have three units, one of which is going to be replaced with the wood-fired boiler, and the other two units will continue to operate as today.
So two-thirds of the capacity of the coal-burning units will still be online in addition to this facility?
That's correct.
Okay. Second, we had seen some discussions and up-to-the-moment discussions on Shattuck Way as far as the role of the town of Newington and PSNH in Portsmouth and opening that up and extending it and using that as a sort of a valve to redirect traffic away from Gosling Road. There was some discussion of a Shattuck Way study. What sort of time frame are we looking at? I know that there are immediate traffic issues that are going to be dealt with. Well, what sort of time frame goals are PSNH, the city, and the town of Newington looking at?
Maybe I can just jump in and have you ask all your questions so that we can kind of keep the flow going.
I didn't know which one was going to be easier, taking notes on each question or... Okay. The other was just more of a question for the department. At the neighborhood meeting in the Atlantic Heights, there was a concern that PSNH could change fuels. And if they did so, then their permitting process would, of course, change with the state, but that the neighborhood, be given an abutter's notice. Is it within the city's purview to stipulate that if fuels are changed, that the city be notified so that they could be involved in the permitting process at the state? And the fourth one that John had touched upon, ash, it was briefly mentioned, and the concern at the Neighborhood Association meeting, and my concern when I'm reading over this is, that with coal ash, it was because of transfer from trucks. It wasn't because it was being burned per se. And my concern is, how is the ash being trucked off, literally going from the silo to the truck? Is it exposed to the open air where winds can take it away to somewhere where you're trading one type of ash for another? And that's it.
I was going to step up and answer two of the questions.
Okay, please do the best you can.
Okay. The question of notification on change of fuel, to the extent there's a state or federal process associated with a change in fuels, PSNH will provide, obviously, the notice required, but to the extent courtesy notices to any of the interested parties Mr. Will talked about, that can be done. So to the extent that there's a change of fuels and PSNH is at the PUC to go through the PUC process associated with the changing of fuels, that type of notice protocol can be accomplished and done. On the question of the study of Shattuck Extension, this is an issue that the city of Portsmouth has consistently put before as part of this process. The city has not studied, has not modeled what the extension of Shattuck to Gosling means in terms of the signalization of Woodbury, for example, the intersection of Woodbury and Gosling. And so what we've tried to do is to address that concern by providing a level of a base of funding so that the city can study the extension. The timing of the actual construction of the extension of Shattuck, the key player, the most dominant player in answering that question is the town of Newington. As part of our traffic mitigation proposal, we're dedicating the corridor over which the town of Newington can lay out a highway, to construct a highway. From the city's point of view, it's been clear throughout that the city believes that the impact, the implications of constructing that extension need to be studied. So the timing, I guess my answer to the question is that the timing of the study, the timing of the construction are in the hands of actors other than PSNH.
Pertaining to the question regarding the ash, as I mentioned, ash is taken off the site via truck. There's two types of trucks. There's completely enclosed trucks that take the ash out dry, so they are filled, they're covered, they're completely enclosed. And the other types of trucks are open-top trucks with a canvas cover, but in those cases, we wet the ash down as part of the process so that it is dust-free. And I believe, was there any more questions? Or?
Actually, that question about changing the fuels.
Sorry, Dave, that question is more of a question for the department. What is the purview of the board to stipulate something?
I don't believe the board has the authority. We have an existing power plant that is functioning under all its licenses. And as part of the PUC, if the wood chips were, I believe coal would be an alternative fuel if it was needed to because of some other issue that would arise. So I would not encourage the board to put any condition of that nature on it.
Madam Chairman, I have one point to add on that just to correct the record. When I talked about the PUC before, I'm informed, in fact, it's Air Resources that would be the regulatory body to which PSNH would go to seek permission to change fuels. I mean, what I said about the notice protocol remains, but now I appreciate Mr. Holden's comments, but it is Air Resources.
Thank you. Any other speakers?
Madam Chair, members of the board, my name is Matthew Upton, and I'm here on behalf of the town of Newington. I'd like to start off by saying the town of Newington supports the application and this project and recognizes the environmental and economic benefits to the state and the region. The town of Newington is pleased to announce that it has reached general agreement with PSNH on some traffic mitigation measures, which include the right-of-way, as Rob has indicated, as well as some financing towards the construction. Town of Newington sees Shattuck Way as a vital part of the transportation mix associated with this project. I've heard two members of the board talk today about the concern of traffic on Gosling, and the town of Newington is also concerned about that traffic. We see Shattuck as a long-term solution for getting the northbound traffic off of Gosling, off of Woodbury, away from the malls, away from the pedestrians, and out on the industrial road where they can pick up Spalding Turnpike up around the Little Bay Bridge. We're going to work with Portsmouth, enter into a dialogue, try to look at ways to minimize any impacts to Woodbury and some of the intersections along Woodbury that might result from the extension of Shattuck. I will say that there's currently an access to Shattuck right now off Piscataqua that's 1,400 feet to the west of the intersection of Gosling and Woodbury. We're not seeing a lot of traffic, non-local traffic, using Shattuck now. But every time we run into a very long backlog at the Little Bay Bridge, it's going to become more tempting as people understand it. And we appreciate that and are sensitive to the issues Portsmouth has raised. Um, I think you've probably heard a lot about the other traffic mitigation steps. The town of Newington is committed to finishing Shattuck. I heard one question as to the time frames. That's going to depend a little bit on how the traffic study comes out, what type of steps need to be taken. The selectmen would like to see project started in the 3 to 5 year time frame. I know that the malls have been very vocal of their concern about the truck traffic on Gosling. They're one of our largest taxpayers, and we certainly want to respond to their needs. So the selectmen would like to do this on the short term. Now, some of this is going to be contingent upon public funding. It's going to have to go through a bonding process, and there'll have to be some public funds put in place. I've spent last Friday speaking with Jeb Bradley, and he indicates that there may be some federal money that may be available to deal with all these traffic issues. And I've got somebody on his staff that's looking into it for the town of Newington, and I assume that those same funds may be available to the city of Portsmouth. So with that said, the town of Newington recommends approval of the project and the application as presented. And I'll answer any questions you might have.
Does anyone have any questions? Thank you for coming, Ms. Upton. Any other speakers? Please state your name and address for the record, please.
Sure. Victoria Simino, and I am at 30 Dearborn Street here in Portsmouth. And I'm here today to speak in favor of the Northern Wood Project for a number of reasons, primarily because I am a dedicated environmentalist, and I do see this project doing many positive things, including lowering emissions at the facility. I'd like to state again that the facility does meet the zoning requirements. This is an existing facility that public service will make improvements to, and again, make this a better place to be, including with broadening the tax base. So that said, again, I'd like to remind the committee here that this project is supported by several societies for the protection of the New Hampshire forest, the Audubon Society of New Hampshire, and many others. It will lower emissions, and it will produce greener electricity without increasing our rates. Millions of dollars will be added to the New Hampshire economy, and the new project will do quite a few positive things for the city. I'm confident that this project should move forward, and I hope that the board agrees. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Madam Chair and members of the Planning Board. My name is Peter Hamlin. I live on 44 Rogers Street in Portsmouth. I also represent the Greater Portsmouth Chamber of Commerce, or a 1,000-member business advocacy organization, and I'm here to represent the Board of Directors, who unanimously voted to support this for two major reasons that align with our strategic goals, which is one is to enhance and sustain the quality of life of both the residents and visitors to our region and the positive economic development of our region. As you heard from many of the speakers, this project by burning wood is going to lower the emissions and clean our air, which is good for our future. And also by PSNH investing, the largest taxpayer in Portsmouth, investing $70 million into this project, we'll see an increase of $20 million going into our local economy while maintaining a working waterfront, which I think is important to everybody and hopefully everybody on the board to maintain those local jobs here at Schiller. So in closing, I hope you will join the list of leaders, both on the local and state level, that enthusiastically endorse this project. Thanks.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, good evening. My name is Frank Quinn. I practice law here in Portsmouth at the law firm of Boynton and Waldron, which is on Court Street. We've been involved on behalf of the malls, also known as the crossings at Fox Run, throughout the local land use process, throughout the TAC process, and on behalf of the malls, just want to thank this board for considering our position tonight. Well, we really echo the position of Newington with regard to this project. Throughout, we've been an opponent of Gosling as the exclusive means of getting these 70 fully loaded tractor trailer trucks in and out of PSNH's project for obvious safety and traffic considerations. We're pleased with the progress that PSNH, the City of Portsmouth, and Newington has made with regard to Gosling, and we think that those immediate concerns and mitigation efforts will benefit our client. But at the end of the day, our position throughout has been that Shattuck, also known as Industrial Way, is the best, most efficient, and safest means of getting trucks in and out of PSNH's site. It will certainly take volume off of Gosling. It will be used for its intended purpose, industrial trucks, and it will certainly allow the project to go forward and to provide the environmental benefits to the residents of New Hampshire and beyond. So we just want to be on record this evening as supporting the project, but making sure that there's as little impact to Gosling and the primary means of access to our client's property, and that this board continue to fully explore the use of Shattuck and Industrial Way in as quick a time frame as is feasible to allow these traffic studies to unfold. Happy to answer any questions, and again, I thank the board for its time.
Any questions? No, thank you.
Madam Chairman, if I could, I wanted to return to a question that really follows on Mr. Quinn's presentation nicely. But Mr. Savremis had a question about trying to appreciate the additional truck traffic and what it means in terms of existing conditions. And I guess I would just ask you to try to put all this in context. Mr. Gorrell talked about the conservative nature that he took in his traffic study, both in terms of the volume of trucks and also in terms of the correspondence he made between a truck and a car. And he put it in context in terms of the existing volume of car traffic. But based on that very conservative approach, he told you that it was a little bit less than a 4% increase in volume. So that's one. And then what I think the hard part is to think about a 4% increase in volume based on these trucks, not in the context of conditions as they exist today, but in the context of the implementation of the traffic improvements that Mr. Gorrell outlined and I kind of headlined. So you're talking, just for example, that lane drop when you go down Gosling and you have those two left lanes going into the mall, that's gone now. You have two through lanes. All this discussion you've just heard with Mr. Upton, particularly on behalf of the town of Newington, the idea of bringing into play Shattuck in a short time frame in terms of bringing into a traffic, integrated traffic solution, a major corridor like that. So it's not a static analysis. It's a little less than 4% projected with these improvements in place. And I guess I'd ask you to consider it in that light. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have any other speakers, two, four, or against? Please state your name and address for the record.
My name's Wendy Lull. I'm the president of the Seacoast Science Center, and I live at 127 Old Pine Hill Road North in Berwick, Maine. And I want to thank you, Madam Chairman and Committee, for the opportunity to speak here. As you know, I sent a letter in support of this project in April, and this is the first time I've really had an opportunity to see how much work has been done to answer a lot of the initial concerns that this project has had. And I would urge the committee to make sure that, as I like to say in the environmental field, we're solving the right problem. And while certainly the truck transportation issue is something that needs to be addressed and certainly not dismissed, the real problem I think we're trying to solve here is improving our air quality. I believe you talked about the state of New Hampshire as being green. At the Seacoast Science Center, we have a new exhibit that's being put up. It's actually in. We're one of the Department of Environmental Services air quality monitoring sites. And we were chosen as one of these sites because we're one of the two public access sites in New Hampshire where you can see ozone. One of them is at the top of Mount Washington, and the other one is at Odeon Point State Park, because those places where you have a very clear view. And while we want to make sure that the state is green, I think we want to make sure that the seacoast is blue, because when you look out over the water, a lot of times in the summertime, it's not a blue sky. There's a thin yellow line of ozone. and we encourage people to come to the seacoast, to go outside, to enjoy the beaches, go for walks in the park, but at the same time, we have to tell them to stay inside because the quality of the air that they're breathing puts their health at risk. This is an important opportunity for us to take a lead position in showing that by choice, one of our larger utilities is trying to start solving the right problem. So I encourage you to support this. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other speakers?
Good evening. Thank you for your patience. I admire you all for being able to sit through these lengthy discussions and make the kinds of planning decisions you do. My name is Sky Marr, and I'm a resident of Portsmouth. I live on Martin Cottage Road, and I'm here tonight wearing two hats, first as a resident and concerned citizen, and second, I'm a member of the Board of Trustees of the Society for the Protection of New Hampshire Forests. We, as a society, are in support of this important project, and as it's been entitled, the Northern Wood Power Project. The Forest Society powers its or heats its own facilities in Concord with a wood fired boiler. It's been extremely effective in multiple aspects of our mission. And we are encouraging the development of this this project in any way that we can, especially as it relates to the continued economic health of the forest product industry in New Hampshire. As you were all aware, we have lost many sawmills in the last few years and paper mills, and the industry needs an outlet for this low-quality wood that we produce so well in New England. I think this is an excellent match of our needs as a community needing energy and the needs of an industry that has long been a major support or a major part of our economic health in New Hampshire. As a resident, we're all aware of, as residents, we're all aware of the number of days we've already had this year with air that is less than the quality we expect. Wendy said it very well. I won't take any more of your time. We know what this is really about, and this is importantly improving our an opportunity to improve our air quality. And while it may not be the answer, it's certainly a step in the right direction. And until we begin to understand how to curb our appetites, we need to be doing everything we can to be working and be cognizant of how we are complicit in this problem of creating bad air. So I applaud Public Service for working at this. I applaud you for the incredibly detailed work that this planning board and the zoning board have gone through. Watching this from the citizen's point of view has been very impressive with the cooperation I've seen with the department's public service company and the cities and neighbors. So again, that's really all I wanted to say. Great, good job continuing a sustainable Portsmouth. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions for Ms. Marr? No.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the Planning Board. My name is Jason Stock. I'm the Executive Director of the New Hampshire Timberland Owners Association. We are the trade association. We represent landowners in the state of New Hampshire, as well as the forest products industry. We have a very active chapter in Rockingham County. It's kind of one of the starting points for our association. We represent over 100 landowners in Rockingham County and over 30 forest-related businesses in the county. We support this project. We support it on two grounds. One, what I would characterize as economic activity, specifically economic activity in the state's more rural areas. Chip purchases, this facility will purchase wood chips. That translates into jobs for foresters, loggers. Also timber tax. A lot of towns across the state, particularly in the more rural areas, a good portion of their budget is based on taxation of timber. And if you don't have a market for the timber, it won't get cut, it won't get taxed, and they won't receive the revenue. So there's another benefit there as well. Also what we call sawmill residue, or chips from sawmills. most sawmills in the state, for instance, Fernald Lumber over in Nottingham, they take a round log, they'll square it up into a cant, saw boards out of it. In that process, they will chip the bark and the slabs. In the days of old, sawmills used to have a tin teepee out back, and they'd throw the wood in there and they would burn it. That's no longer allowed, and now what sawmills do is they chip it, and they will send it to facilities such as this and utilize it. And why that's important is it's not only better for the environment, but also it gives you better utilization of that tree, and that translates into better value for the landowner for that log or that tree growing in their woodlot. The second aspect of this project that we really like is the benefits to forestry. I heard a couple questions tonight about clear cutting and the implications to the state's forest. The state of New Hampshire, as you've heard already, we're second most forested state in the nation. We're about 80, across the entire landscape, we're about 84% forested. What's interesting is that about 100 years ago, it was just the opposite. Around the turn of the century, it was just the opposite. It was about 15 to 20% forested. And what that demonstrates is that the state of New Hampshire and our climate and our soils, we have an excellent climate for growing trees, and they naturally regenerate. We don't have to do plantations like many of the more arid parts of the western U.S. and in the south. So we have very good natural regeneration. And as a result, we grow a lot of wood. We grow a lot of wood very quickly. Unfortunately, about 35 to 40% of the wood we grow would be deemed low-grade wood. That's based on USDA Forest Service inventory data. These are low-grade wood is wood that's either too crooked or it has a sway in it, can't be used for a saw log. Well, that wood, you need a market for it. Because when you cut a tree down, usually it's the first, you'll take a saw logs off the first, what they'll call the butt of the tree, and then the rest of it, in order to fully utilize that and reap the most economic benefit out of that tree, generally what happens is it will be converted into pulpwood and used for paper, or it'll be chipped and used for power production. Given that it's about 35 to 40% of the total biomass growing in that forest, as a landowner trying to do good management, I need a home for that, because that affects the economics of my thinning operation or the stewardship that I'm trying to perform. Without a market, what unfortunately will happen, and we've seen this in past history, is it's called high grading, where they'll cut the best and leave the rest. And in those instances, what you're left with are stands that have trees that have low vigor, low market value, and consequently, the total value of that woodlot, it becomes depressed, and over time, it is you start seeing inferior species and inferior what they call regeneration. So we like this project because of the economic benefits. We also like it because of the forestry aspect of it. In terms of the actual impacts to forestry, there was a study done in around 1994 for the State Division of Forest and Lands that went back. They did some biomass harvesting, and then they went back and looked at those stands to see what was happening. And in total, they saw growth rates increase upwards of 40%. Again, you release, you do that thinning, and it's not unlike your garden. You plant a lot of carrots, you thin them out, the resulting carrots are going to have much more vigor and they're going to grow much better. We saw growth rates increase upwards of 40%. We saw overall the timber value on an annual basis increase by about 7.2%. So why that's significant is, as a landowner, I have a piece of land that I'm managing or I'm paying the taxes on and I'm maintaining. My ability to grow wood on that and do it profitably will make me as a landowner much more inclined to keep that as forest land or timberland as opposed to converting it to another use. So the interplay for landowners in open space and markets is profound. Without the markets, that land is more apt to be converted to other uses. And we've heard it mentioned tonight, we all enjoy New Hampshire because of its green backdrop, Well, that's brought to you by the forest of the state, private landowners, and some public land as well. And how that's, what keeps that land green is the fact that there are markets and that those people that own that land can afford to grow those trees and keep it as open space. So we fully support this project, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other speakers? 2-4 or against? Any other speakers? Okay, Mr. Will?
I'll be really brief. I like this project just as much as the next person. I don't want to give anybody the wrong impression, but there is one thing that concerns me, and that is the presence of coal and wood ash, that is coal dust and wood ash, that would still be present because it would be using two types of fuel at the facility. If there could be a stipulation to provide some sort of covering or specific covering for the coal ash, the coal dust that is presently being used, as well as the wood ash that will be used. My concern is that as it's being moved from the trucks, that in contact with the open air, that it will somehow move over and across to neighborhoods. While the air quality would certainly be better, the Atlantic Heights neighborhood has to deal with every now and then after a fresh snowfall and a really cold winter, they come out and they see little black things on the snow. And my concern is we're trading one type of ash for another. So while I like this project a lot, I think it's, and my concern is, I feel, is certainly valid. It's fixable, I believe, by a single stipulation added to the plan. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other speakers? You want to just quickly address that?
May I?
Please.
Well, with regard to the coal dust, we have a very extensive coal dust, coal management plan. We do cover the coal piles as he's requested. We currently do that, and we use, you know, we use a tarp mechanism each time we put we unload coal, and after we groom it, compact it to minimize dust. We have dust suppression systems on our conveyors. We spray the coal piles as necessary. We monitor winds, and we keep track of any unusual weather patterns that may be coming in, so we can be prepared. In addition, as a result of some issues that have been raised and concerns raised with regards to the potential of coal dust reaching some of these neighborhoods that were addressed earlier, Atlantic Heights and Osprey Landing, we are in the process of setting up some air sampling in the Osprey Landing neighborhood, and we will be doing some simultaneous testing on our property in the direction of Atlantic Heights. And that will be taking place hopefully in the next month or two, so that we can get a better determination on exactly what kind of particulate is potentially leaving our site and heading in those directions. In terms of the ash, ash is contained. We have existing silos that are completely enclosed. The wood ash will be contained within a silo, and as I mentioned before, if it's loaded dry, it will be in enclosed, in completely enclosed containers, covers, fixed covers, and to the extent that they are transported in open top trucks, it is wetted first. As it's coming down, it's mixed with water, and it comes out more as a slight mud when it gets into the truck, and then there's a tarp that goes over the top of the truck. We have been hauling ash for over almost 20 years now, and because we have been burning coal, and never have had any kind of concerns with that, to my recollection, with the trucks when they're on the roads with regards to any ash being of concern in the on the road system or anywhere. Thank you.
We would just have a follow-up question.
How does the ash get from the silo into the trucks? Is it direct deposit? There's no loader involved? This goes right from the silo into the truck, am I correct? Or?
It goes from the silo. If it gets wetted, it goes through a wetting piece of machinery into the truck. Otherwise, it's a direct source to the truck itself.
Thank you.
And a question also. The soot that Mr. Willis was talking about, is that coming from the coal and the process, or is it coming from your stacks?
I guess I didn't hear anything about soot. I
don't believe it's soot. I believe it's... I think the concern, John, was as they're transferring the coal it'd be pre-burnt, I mean coal, but that dust is a lot of times what comes over. There is some concern. People believe it's soot. The jury is still out on that. I won't say for or against that. There's some people in the neighborhood who believe it is soot, but the issue is that as things are transferred, I think the point is that the existing condition is right now, this winter, people come out of their houses after a fresh snowfall, black stuff. Now, whether that's coal dust or soot, I don't pretend to know. I assume it's probably coal dust from transfer, but that is a concern in the neighborhood. It has been a concern in the neighborhood as long as I've been a member of the neighborhood committee. Before I even lived in the neighborhood, I remember Karen Swanson was talking about it in 1994. So it is an existing condition, and my concern is that because those plants are still operating and you're creating another plant, another type of plant, that may also create a similar situation that could just easily, we have an opportunity here with all these consultants, everybody here, to actually just mitigate that one little thing. It seems pretty reasonable.
I was just going to try to put a context on this discussion. I mean, remember the fundamental feature of this whole project is to replace an outdoor coal storage pile with an indoor wood storage facility. It's basically to contain, it's to replace one fuel source, which is much more, mobile, I guess, with another source that's going to be secured indoors that's less mobile. So the context here is favorable in terms of addressing these issues just by the very nature, the fundamental nature of the project.
Bob, the reason I asked a question about the filtration of the stacks was that I didn't know whether what Mr. Wills was talking about was coming from the residue coming out of the stacks. As you know, that it's hot and there's a lot going up into the air from some of those stacks. And in fact, years ago in Portsmouth, when the trains were running right down the B&M, people all down in Strawberry Bank didn't dare put their laundry out on the lines because of the steam and the smoke and the soot coming up from those trains. And that stuff travels in the wind quite a bit, because in Portsmouth, the predominating winds come from the Schiller Station towards the ocean. And I was just wondering if they've taken that into consideration.
First of all, just to make sure, with regard to any particulate leaving the stack, there is the bag house that I referred to that is the emission control device that specifically is designed for that, and we are regulated with regards to that. The other thing I would just mention to the board as well is in 1999, New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services did what they refer to as the Elliott study, where they did some extensive studying, air sampling, similar to the air sampling that we are going to do. And in there, and as a result of that study, they determined that the total particulate in the air was well below the national air quality, ambient air quality standard. And in fact, they went on to say that in their view of a worst case scenario, the total particulate would be well below the national air quality standard. Ambient air quality standard. So this was just done in 1999, and you're right, the prevailing wind is downriver, and that is why they did that sampling in that general area in Elliott, Maine, which is just
directly
across.
Unless you had a zero admittance from your stacks, the people in Atlantic Heights are always going to get, and you're burning coal, you're always going to get some residue and some downwind fallout from your stacks.
As in any combustion process, similar to vehicles.
That's right. I'm not picking on you in general, but he happens to live in an area that is difficult to manage that way. Thank you.
Any other speakers?
Madam Chair, before you close, perhaps I could have Rob confirm where we're heading on the fiscal improvements. Am I correct that that what is being proposed would provide approximately $500,000 towards short-term improvements, $500,000 towards long-term improvements, $125,000 towards the study, and that those monies would be provided to the city for the completion of those related projects?
Generally correct, as you said before, Mr. Holden. These are matters that are going to be subject of continuing discussion between the city and PS&H and the other interested parties. Obviously, the town of Newington is a party to this, as well as the Department of Transportation. But generally, as I said in my presentation, what we are proposing as a traffic mitigation proposal is to pay to the city approximately $1 million, and the precise amount of our contribution will be worked out once we sort through, for example, who will be responsible for the design and survey of the Gosling Road project is the most prominent example. I think that really might account for the difference between the figures that you're using and my just making a statement of a more general figure. So that as we move forward, you're fundamentally correct in terms of what we'll be doing, and what I said before, we believe that that contribution will serve the immediate, intermediate, and long-term interests of the parties. So I don't know if that's satisfactory to you.
Perhaps I could ask John Burke to come down and verify that this is where we're at. Am I correct that it's $1 million, or is it $1,125,000?
I believe the latest information that I saw was $1.125 million, or $1,150,000, I should say.
That was mine, too.
What I was referring to is that there were some questions arose today about the proposal that we put before the city was $1.15 million with the idea that the city of Portsmouth would administer, design, and survey the improvements of Gosling. And there were questions raised today about whether, in fact, there was a more efficient way to attack this process, and that there would be a more, we'd have a better program if perhaps those functions were contracted or absorbed by PS&H acting as agent for the city. And so the difference between the two numbers really reflects that. And the only reason I'm using approximately $1 million is because that point remains unsettled. And it really is probably one of the few points that does remain unsettled. And so that's the only reason I'm creating a little flexibility in the number.
This comes to a further discussion when the board has a motion, and if it were to be a favorable motion, I think we can address this remaining issue to everyone's satisfaction. But I think the department would be indicating that we understood it to be the figure that John Burke and I both commented on. But as negotiations, not so much are continuing, but are being refined, I think that matter will resolve itself.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I would now like to read into the record an email which Chairman Ken Smith received from John Thomas, who is a representative in the state legislature and chair of the House Science, Technology, and Energy Committee. This apparently was sent yesterday, May 26, 2004. Dear Chairman Smith, I'm writing to you concerning the conversion of one boiler at Public Service of New Hampshire's Schiller Station in Portsmouth. I'm aware that the City of Portsmouth is reviewing the impacts of the conversion. However, as Chair of the Science, Technology, and Energy Committee in the State Legislature, I believe it is important to provide any information that you and your board may find necessary to review, since we have worked for many years on the issue of burning wood to produce electricity, the environmental benefit of this type of generation, and the subsequent benefits to the economy of the State of New Hampshire.
My committee continues to be updated on the status of the proposal and has worked closely with the PUC to ensure that all issues associated with the project have been fairly reviewed. One of the issues that remained constant throughout the electric utility restructuring discussion, as I'm sure you will remember, was always in the forefront, was New Hampshire's position in the energy market. Positioning was one of the main reasons we kept New Hampshire's restructuring efforts flexible. It has not changed today. We, as an overall net exporter of power, should not relinquish that power, as it would certainly take significant benefits away from our residents as to pricing of power and to regional air quality if that position should reverse. A major component of that structure is the diversity of fuel used for generation. Whereas the Schiller Station will be a major source of alternative generation using primarily local supplies, it is of utmost importance that the Schiller Station retrofit move forward for the benefit of all of the state's ratepayers. One of the biggest benefits to the city of Portsmouth and the surrounding area will be the increase in air quality. This has also been a large consideration of the restructuring discussions that continue today in a joint oversight committee that I chair. As your board, the city of Portsmouth, and the surrounding communities investigate this wood for fuel proposal, please don't hesitate to contact me if I can provide any further information. Respectfully yours, John H. Thomas. So, any other thoughts, questions for any other speakers at this point? Okay. I declare the public hearing closed, and I weigh a motion.
Madam Chair, I think the department, just in summary, would like to indicate to you that we, the department, the town of Newington, the Rockingham Planning Commission, New Hampshire DOT, have all come together to try to address the issues. I think they've been very fairly represented. I think we have the tone and all the components of the agreements coming together. This is a very complex project, but very encouraged. I think the TAC comments that are relevant can be all summarized and should be included. But the one condition, if you're looking at where the department has provided you with the conditions, would be the following. That prior to the issuance of a building permit, a fully executed agreement be shown to the planning director to exist between Public Service of New Hampshire, the Town of Newington, the New Hampshire Department of Transportation, and the City of Portsmouth regarding the manner in which the Gosling Road improvements will be constructed by the City of Portsmouth. That actually allows us to make sure that there is no quibbling on the dollar amounts and that the agreements are reached between the Town of Newington and New Hampshire DOT. So if there were a motion along those lines, would suggest that that condition be included along with those from TAC.
Madam Chairman, I would move the acceptance of the report of the project with all of the stipulations that came to us from TAC, along with the statement that Mr. Holden just presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
I will not vote for this project because of my concerns for traffic. It has not been demonstrated that trucks coming, heading north and trucks heading south will not create chaos on Gosling Road. So for that reason, I will not support.
Any other thoughts? Quiet group after all of that. Okay.
Move the question.
All those in favor, say aye.
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 Against.
Well, one opposed. Any abstentions? Okay. Motion carries. And I'd like to thank the representatives of PSNH for all their cooperation with the city in the past and as we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Thank you, members of the board.
Yeah, thank you. Motion to adjourn. Do we have one?
Oh, yeah, some moved.
All right. Thank you.
You get the 9:35.
Promise
is still protected.
Well, Rich rules, right?
Okay.